عليكم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Good afternoon, everybody. In this episode, I'm going to talk about the fourth class in linguistics. That's the class assigned to students at the University of Benghazi, Faculty of Languages, Department of English, fifth or sixth semesters. The last three episodes, I talked about the linguistics, the study of theoretical, human language, about language, about features of language, other things. The second episode, I talked about the history of linguistics, either old linguistics or modern linguistics. The last episode, I talked about morphology. Morphology is the study of the internal structure of words. So morphology is concerned with words, not with the phrases or clauses or sentences. We talked about the free morpheme and said any word is a morpheme, but not any morpheme is a word. So a free morpheme is a word at the same time. A word, it means that a word, a letter or a phoneme or a set of phonemes or a set of letters that make meaning. For example, cat is a free morpheme and it's a word. Whereas the bound morpheme that we add other either prefixes that what comes before or suffixes that what comes after to the original or the root word which is called the free morpheme. Let's say for example, cat, this is a free morpheme, whereas cats, it's a bound morpheme, consists of two morphemes, cat as a singular and s to make it plural. Like, for example, as a free morpheme, dislike, as we added a prefix, this to make it don't like, or liked, we change in the tense to make it in the past. We divided the morphemes into three, either derivational, that works with the class, or meaning. We change the meaning of the word, for example, possible, adjective, impossible, adjective, but we change the meaning, like, verb, dislike, verb. Either for the class, we change the class of the word. For example, possible is adjective, possibly is adverb, or possibility is noun. So here we change the class from adjective, either noun or adverb, or say write as a verb, writer as a noun, or writing as a gerund. So here we change the class of the verb into noun or gerund. The other one is inflectional. Inflectional consists of three components. That the first one is gender. Gender, when we add S with he, she, it. For example, he goes, she goes, or trains, we add S with the verb. Or number, consistently with the plural, singular, plural. For example, cat, singular, cats, plural, child, singular, children, plural, ox, oxen, etc. And for the tense, we change because we are dealing in morphology with just only one word. So we are in tense, actually, we focus on just only past symbol, not with the other tenses. So adding ed, or maybe a regular verb, for example, write, wrote. For example, write or wrote. So here, write is a free morpheme, whereas wrote is a two morpheme word, consists of write and the regular form of the verb wrote. So here, a word with two morphemes. For the tense, that's it. We talked about, I think, the last class. So this class, we are going to talk about syntax. As we said before that linguistics is the study of language or human language or theoretical study of human language. Morphology is the study of the internal structure of words. So here's syntax. What's syntax? Syntax is the study of the structure of words in a sentence. So here we move from the level of word up to the level of phrase or clause. So syntax is the study or structure or order of a word, of words in a sentence. Syntax and morphology actually consists of what's called grammar in its narrower sense. So grammar consists of morphology and syntax. This is narrower level. So the study of structure or order of words in a sentence. Within syntax, as we are talking about the level of upper than the word, so we have to talk about phrases. So what's a phrase? To know a phrase, let's go to see what are levels or what are units of language. Let's see units of language, and we later we'll see units of sentence. As we know that units of language, what are units of language? The first or the smallest unit of language, we call it allophone. Allophone is the smallest unit of language. Allophone means sound. Sound, for example, pa in help and pa in please. They have though the p here and p here are similar, but they have different sounds. Help, pa with aspiration. Help, please. Help, please. Help, please. So pa here doesn't have aspiration, whereas here it has aspiration clearly, explicitly. So please, please. The second smallest unit of language was called phoneme. Phoneme or letter. This is sound, and this is letter, or phoneme. Phoneme such as a. This is a phoneme. Ta is a phoneme, a letter. It doesn't have any meaning such as the sound unless it's associated or linked to other sounds. Here, ta doesn't have, or r or f or any phoneme doesn't have any meaning unless it's associated or linked to other phonemes. For example, you say cat. So t here gives the meaning that this is the animal that's used as a pet, cat. Whereas when you change the letter or the phoneme T into R, we change the meaning of the word here. So R or T doesn't have any meaning themselves unless they are joined to other phonemes. Cat is an animal used as a pet. Car is a machine or automobile that's used for transportation. The third one that we studied last week, which is morpheme. A morpheme, as we said before, that a morpheme might be a free word. A free morpheme might be a word, or might be that a letter, or phoneme, or some other phonemes that's added to other words to make a new word with another morphemes, such as, for example, say like, dislike. This is a word. So this will say dislike. So here, this is a phoneme, and this is a phoneme. So this doesn't have meaning unless it's associated with like or un, for example. Unnecessary. Un doesn't have any meaning itself unless it's added. S doesn't have any meaning unless it's added to another word. So a morpheme, by the way, is the smallest meaningful unit of language. So meaning starts from here. So for the sound, the allophone, the phoneme actually don't have meaning. The meaning when they are joined to other words. Whereas the phoneme, in the case of the free morpheme, so this is the smallest, so morpheme is the smallest meaningful unit of language. Or the smallest unit of language that has meaning. After phoneme, it comes the word. A word might have more than 3, 4, 5, as I said before, phonemes, morphemes, such as understanding, for example. Or misunderstanding. It's just only one word. This is one word. one word. And this word consists of 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe 5. So it's one word. A word what? A word is what could be a word. A letter, such as A in a car, or I as a personal speaker pronoun. It could be a letter, or it could be a group of letters that join together to give meaning, general meaning, in fact. So I say, multi-misunderstanding, this is a word, consists of 5 morphemes. Understand, misunderstand, understandings, understandings, multi-misunderstanding. So, misunderstanding, just only one word. And what comes after the word is a phrase. As we say, a word in morphology, actually we are dealing with words, means separate words. Whereas in syntax, we deal with a phrase. So what's a phrase? A phrase, is a syntactic structure of at least 2 words that have a semantic relationship, a semantic and syntactic. So here when you talk about a phrase, we talk about at least 2 words. Not one word. For example, of course, I'm going to just to see after phrase, it comes the clause, and we have 2 types of clause, either dependent or independent. Such as we say, if a clause, of course, doesn't have meaning. Some dependent clauses doesn't have meaning unless they are joined to another independent clause. Such as if it rains, it's a clause with subject verb. Here, actually, we'll stop here. This we call, we're not dealing with sentences, but here we deal with clause. If it rains, it doesn't have meaning unless it's joined to another independent clause. So say, if it rains, I stay home, for example. Sentence. We have, of course, 4 kinds of sentence: symbol, compound, complex, and compound complex. Paragraph. Text and context. So these are the units of language: allophone, sound, phoneme, letter, morpheme, word, phrase, clause, sentence, paragraph, text, and context. So we are actually concerned in this lesson today about the phrase. So what's a phrase? A syntactic structure of at least 2 words. For example, we'll say boy. This is a word. Boys, it's still a word. But this is a free word, a free morpheme. But this is a pound morpheme. But when we say the boy, so here it's a phrase. Why? Because it consists of 2 words, separate words. The and boys, 2 words. So we have in English, we have either noun phrase in which the head is the noun. The head is the main word. For example, when you say the boy, the boy. So here the head is boy. I'm talking about the boy. The boy is noun phrase. And the other things we call it adjunct or subordinate that support the word boy and works as adjective. What comes before, we call it a modifier. What comes after, we call it qualifier. Or we can call it attributive and we call it predictive. So here we say the boy, it's a noun or phrase. The head here where is the boy. We can make up to maybe 5 or 10 words. Let's say that here we have this dead boy. And this is the head boy. Oh boy. So the head here is boy. We can say, let's say for example, the good boy. Still, it's now in a phrase, the head is boy. We can say, for example, the boy sitting there. The boy sitting there. It's still, the head is the boy. I'm talking about which boy? The boy who is sitting there. So here, the sitting there works as a qualifier. So till how, for the phrase, actually, we don't have verbs. Just only words. Let's say, for example, we say the good boy that I talked with you about last week, for example. So look here, this is a noun or phrase. Consists of how many words? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. This is a phrase, noun or phrase. Consists of 11 words. The head here is where? The boy is the head. This is the head. So it's a noun or phrase. What comes before the boy is a modifier. It gives attribution to the boy. The boy, the good boy, not the bad boy, the first thing, the good boy. And suppose that we have many good boys. Many good boys and many bad boys. So when I say the good boy, so in this case we exclude the bad boys. We focus only one of the boys who are good. And the other thing, I need another explanation because we have many boys. So the good boy, not the bad boy, and that, the good boy that I'm talking about, that I talked with you about last week. So here we don't have a verb. Still, this is a modifier, and this a qualifier. So this gives some information about the boy, and this gives another explanation. This is a word, and this is a clause. A word that works as a modifier to give attribution to the boy, and this is a qualifier to give us extra information about the boy. So here we don't have a verb, and this is not a sentence, this is a phrase. If you want to make this into a sentence, it's so easy, just only we add a verb, because here we don't have a verb. This is subject. The boy that I talked with you about last week, this is the subject. One person. I'm talking about the boy. So I can replace the good boy that I talked with you about last week. We can put just only one word, he. So here, a representative of the whole clause, the whole phrase. We can add, for example, he died. So this is the verb. Here we can also say, the good boy that I talked with you about last week. So what happened? Let's say died. So here we are dealing with the phrase. This is the noun phrase. So the noun phrase, at least two words. The boy, the good boy, the boy sitting there, the boy that I talked with you about last week or yesterday. Also, the verb phrase. We have verb phrase. Verb phrase consists of at least two verbs. For example, you say write. Let's say write. Write is a word. Or let's say, for example, play. Write or play is a one word with one morpheme. It's a free morpheme and word at the same time. When we say rights, it's a word with two morphemes, gender. When you say, for example, played, so here, still one word with two morphemes, tense. But imagine that we say how to change it into a verb phrase. We have to add another word or another words, let's say. We can say, for example, will write. So here will write, it's still a verb, and the head is still right, because you know that verbs actually sometimes got lexical meaning, sometimes, and some kinds of verbs got grammatical meaning, function. Well, actually, auxiliary verbs don't have meanings, but they have function, grammatical meanings. Whereas the main verbs, actually, they have lexical meaning. That's content, we call it meaning. So here, will write, it's a phrase with auxiliary verb and main verb. Or let's say had played. It's a phrasal verb with the auxiliary and past participle of the verb. Let's say, for example, is going or must leave. So these are phrases. They are not words. They are not morphemes. Why? Because they consist of at least two. Sometimes a three, sometimes four. For example, will be waiting. So here, it's where is the head here? The head is where? Wait. This is the head. And the others are, this is the adjunct, and this is the head. And these are the subordinates, either the subordinate comes before or after. Maybe if we change it into a passive voice, for example. So, also we might have adjective phrase. Adjective phrase. So you say, for example, you know that the adjective might be attributive, might be predictive. For example, good is a morpheme. Whereas we can make it phrase by adding other subordinates or other adjuncts, but the head is still be good. For example, you say, very good. So here I'm talking, the head is still good. So here, very good. Very actually gives the degree. We call it adverb of degree. So very good, or maybe too good, or so good, or quite good. Oh, no, we cannot say rather, but let's say rather good. By the way, for the word very, the connotation of very is positive, whereas the connotation of too is negative. Though they give the same semantic meaning. For example, you say that this class or this room is too small, it means that I cannot use this room in recording, for example. Why? Because too gives the connotation of negative. Whereas when I say this room is very small, it means that very small, but I like it. So the connotation is positive. Also quite used with the positive things. When I say he's quite good, this is good you cannot say rather good because rather is used with negative. For example, you say that he's rather angry or he's quite generous. So very good, two words, and they consist adjective phrase. Sometimes we make what we call it equivalent. Equivalent. An adjective means the same degree. For example, good and strong, for example. It's adjective phrase consists of two phrases. There's actually the two phrases are equal in either function and semantic means, unless they differ just only on the emphasis. Either I'm talking about the good to emphasize the adjective or the attribution of good rather than strong. This is for the adjective. We have adverb phrase. So for the adverb phrase, as we know that we have the manner, for example, we say, for example, instead of good, we can say well. We can use the same as we did with the adjective. We can say very well or very badly. We can say quite well, quite badly, etc. We can use. When it comes to the prepositional, prepositional phrase. So preposition is what? N, on, for example, to, for, etc. These are prepositions. So the focus here is what? In the preposition. Not in the, for example, you say, in the classroom. So here the focus is on N, the preposition in where. Where is he? So here the focus is about the location, the preposition. Oh, he is in the classroom. I'm not concerned about the classroom, but I'm concerned about the location. Where is he? In the classroom. So in here is the focus. So I'll say on the table. Where is the book? It's on the table, on the table. So the focus is on, not on the table. Where are you going to? I'm going to Tripoli, for example. So to Tripoli, I'm not focusing on Tripoli, but to where I'm going to. Where are you leaving for? I'm leaving for London, let's say. So London, the focus is on the preposition. So we call it a prepositional phrase. So these are the phrases that we know now, the difference between word is just only single word. Whereas a phrase that two, at least two, might be 10, might be 12, as we said that, as we showed before, 11 words of just only one phrase. So if we talk about the syntax, there are actually three types of syntax. Three types of syntax. The one is minor syntax, that's for the phrase, as I showed you earlier, phrase, two words or more, noun phrase, verb phrase, etc. So in English we have either noun phrase, verb phrase, adjective phrase, adverbial phrase, or prepositional phrase. These are the phrases. And for the words, we have either noun, let's say noun, verb, adjective, adverb, and preposition. The second one, or the second type of syntax is called major syntax. So major syntax actually deals with sentences, not with the phrases. So here we go up, as we showed you before, that allophone, phoneme, morpheme, word, phrase, close, sentence, paragraph, text. So number 7, I think, allophone, phoneme, morpheme, word, phrase, close, sentence. Number 7, sentence, and number 8, text, and number 9, paragraph number 9. So sentence and text. So here, the major is concerned with the sentences. When you talk about sentences, actually, we talk about two types to analyze a sentence. We can analyze the sentence, analysis of the sentence, either as unit or as class. When it comes to unit, so we are dealing with these. Noun phrase, verb phrase, adjective phrase, adverbial phrase, prepositional phrase, noun, verb, adjective, adverb, or preposition. We have either determiner, that, this, that, etc. So Let's see that how we deal with the unit. The unit of the sentence. The unit of the sentence is that we classify the sentences according to its units. Let's say, for example, the nice lady has given the little boy the present, for example. This is a simple sentence with just only one subject. It might have more than a verb, but here it has just only one verb. So this is a simple sentence. If you want to classify this sentence into its units, so I have to think of noun phrase, verb phrase, adjective phrase, adverb phrase, or noun, etc. Let's see, for example, the nice lady. Now let's first that, as we said before about Bloomfield, about the structuralism, let's classify this sentence into its main constituents. Where are the constituents of this sentence? The first one, the nice lady has given the little boy the present. So this sentence actually consists of 1, 2, 3, 4 constituents, 4 parts. Let's see the first part. It falls under noun phrase. Why? Because the head is where? Lady. Has given is the verb phrase. Why? Because the head is give. The little boy is still its noun phrase. The present is noun phrase. So here, in this case, that I classify the sentence into its units such as noun phrase, verb phrase, noun phrase, noun phrase. So we have here 3 noun phrases and 1 verb phrase. Let's see the parts of the noun phrase itself. The noun phrase consists of what? The is determiner. Nice, adjective. It's not adjective phrase because we are dealing with words here. And noun. Here the same. Auxiliary and verb. Here the same. Determiner, adjective, and noun. Here, determiner and noun. So in this case, we classify or we divide the sentence into its main constituents first, and within the constituents, we divide them into noun phrases and words. Make sure that you make the constituents well at the beginning, because if you misuse or misclassify the constituents or the classification of the sentence, you will misuse the attribution of the noun phrase itself. Let's say I give you another complex sentence to see how to... let's say, for example, the little boy crying loudly had wanted the young lady. Let's say, this is a sentence. It's a simple sentence with one subject and one verb. So here, let's say that, where is the subject here? Or let's first, most of the mistakes or errors that students make that they see that this is the verb. By the way, the verb with ing never comes unless there's verb to be before. If there's no verb to be, so it's an adjective. We call it participle in language. So here we don't have, we say that the little boy is crying, so is crying is a verb. Whereas here crying means what? Means who was crying. But as I say, the forative clause, when we delete who, we delete verb to be and we keep the verb in ing. So here, the little boy crying loudly, this is one constituent. Had wanted, another constituent. The young lady, another. So here, one, two, three. If we divide this into four, so here we misuse the noun phrases and verb phrases. So here, this is the subject, we call it noun phrase. Why? Because the head is boy. And this is verb phrase, and this is noun phrase. So here within this we can say the determiner, adjective, noun, crying loudly, this is the whole, is adjective, consists of crying, your gerund, and this is adverb. So here, the little boy crying loudly, just only one constituent. Had wanted, this is auxiliary, and this is the verb. Determiner, adjective, and noun. This is for the unit. Let's say that the other time they talk about the class. So for the unit, actually we are dealing with noun phrase, verb phrase, noun phrase, adjective phrase, adverbial phrase. Let's say that the little boy crying loudly had wanted the young lady. We cannot put last because we use this had. Let's change this into something we'll ask, let's say. We'll ask the young lady, or we'll give the young lady a present next week, for example. So here, that's because we cannot use the past participle with the yesterday or something. So here, the present, another constituent, which consists of noun phrase. But here, the next week, it's a noun phrase, still noun phrase. We don't have an adverb. Okay, see, if we still have time, I'll give you an example about the adverb. In the next class, inshallah, I talk about the class. Okay, let me finish this. Give you some examples about the adverb phrase and the adjective phrase. When we talk about the adjective phrase, in fact, we talk about the complement, subject and verb. So I say that this new car seems very expensive. So this new car seems very expensive. This sentence consists of three constituents. The first one is this new car. It's a noun phrase. Seems, it's not a verb phrase, it's verb because it consists just only one word. So pay attention that it's not a phrase, it's one word. Whereas very expensive, this is adjective phrase. So we use actually adjective phrase with the complement, linking verbs. Seem, get, sound, appear, verb to be, consider. So we cannot use the adjective phrases with the main verbs. So here noun phrase is what? Determiner, adjective, and noun. Here the verb, and here what? The degree, and the adjective. Let's see another example with the adverb of place, or let's see another example with the prepositional phrase. Say, for example, he is going to a nice city by car next month, for example. Let's see this sentence. Now let's say change this into the boy to give extra examples. So the boy is going to a nice city by car next month. So how many can say the boy is going to a nice city by car next month? So here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Five constituents. Let's see the constituent. This is noun phrase. Why? Because the head is noun. And here's the verb phrase. Here's the prepositional phrase. Why? Because you can't distinguish between adverbial phrase, a prepositional phrase or noun phrase by asking, for example, we're here noun phrase, you can ask by who, what, and where, how, and what. So here we can say noun phrase. This is by car, is an adverb phrase, because it shows how, by car, how. And this is noun phrase. So here we have determiner, we have noun, auxiliary, we have verb, preposition, article, indefinite article, adjective, noun, preposition, noun, determiner, and noun. I think it's okay for today, inshallah ta'ala, next class or next episode, I'll talk more details about this because it's a little bit complicated. So just only to give a brief overview about what I have already done. In a minute or two, that's the time limitation for us because of uploading video. Thanks for the channel of Libya, Ruh Al Watan, for providing us this opportunity to present to our students classes in linguistics. Thank you for the president of the university, Dr. Azadeen Idrisi. Thanks to the head of the dean of the faculty of language, Dr. Nawar Salma, and all other who are supporting this idea. The Minister of Higher Education, Dr. Fawzi Boumaris. So just only to give a brief overview about the syntax. Syntax, of course, they study the order, the structure of the words in the sentence. We classify syntax into minor, such as a phrase, noun phrase, verb phrase, adjective phrase, prepositional phrase. And in sentences, unit class, inshallah ta'ala, We already finished the unit, but inshallah next class or next episode I talk in more details about the unit and talk about the class and how we deal with the classes and constituents in one sense, because it's very complicated. In fact, in case that you need any inquiries, you got some confusion, you can contact with me, Dr. Yusuf Zaghwani Omar, the head of the European and Asian language at the Faculty of Languages at the University of Benghazi. Thank you very much and appreciate your help, Mr. Tariq Al-Houni, Mr. Malik, and Mr. Nasri for providing us this opportunity. I appreciate it a lot. Thanks a lot.